Board of Health meeting on October 18th, 2017. For tonight's topics of discussion, I'd like to at least maybe discuss our open to public discussion, which we have not had on the agenda before. But it may, I think it may be good to us to incorporate that. I know I've had discussion with a couple people, with Joan and actually people outside of Town Hall. And what I've watched too with the selectmen's meeting, Kevin, you were selectman for 3 years,
yep.
Correct? Did you find that a open discussion was beneficial? That's something that you had an ongoing thing with?
I think it's always beneficial to hear what the public's going to say. So, you know, typically public discussions are basically the sole and exclusive right of the chair, in this case yourself, as well as the chair of the Board of Selectmen or any other. So, you know, how you want to set it up is completely up to you. You know, if you have a big topic,
sure.
For example, you may want to limit the amount of time that each speaker can speak so you can make sure that everybody gets a chance to say something without taking up an hour of your meeting. But it's always helpful.
And as far as a member of the Board of Selectmen, you found it helpful to get input from the public?
Yeah, absolutely. You know, a lot of times you get a different perspective on things that you may not have had walking through the door. Everybody sees things a little bit differently, and it's nice to hear those different perspectives on different issues.
Heidi, did you concur? Do you think that would be something you would like to see us institute?
Yeah, I think so, yeah.
As you can see tonight, I don't know if there's that many people here, and they may be coming, but...
Well, if I may, Mr. Chairman, maybe in the future you can just limit it to 5 minutes on the agenda. and I don't say that more for, as a joking standpoint, that we don't have a lot of folks in the room, but you can extend that as much as you want.
Mm-hmm.
So in this case, we have to wait until 6:15, for example, to start the public hearing, but
yep.
We could certainly start at 6:20, mm-hmm. at 6:30 if we needed to.
Okay. Does anyone in the public have any items to discuss? Yes.
I'll say about this. If this was available on the PDF that you got to see what this meeting is, I think it would help the public have knowledge to speak in the meeting as well. So if if I've read this prior to coming here, I would have something to go off with the questions right here.
And I'm sorry, is that the mm-hmm. handout that we
yes.
that we got tonight? Okay.
And again, excuse me, Mr. Chairman, if I may, the one thing that is typical and normal is to ask people to identify themselves in their street address.
Sure.
Or their street,
yeah.
I should say.
Yeah.
It's kind of a common,
sure.
common
have
thing.
Have you had a chance to sign in also?
Yeah.
Is that, okay.
Great. So what's the document that you have in your hand that you're referencing?
Well,
Oh, right here. Okay. Okay.
But online on the City Hall, it just had just the date and time of the meeting with the links and the
okay.
Nice.
So where was this generated from?
Laura has printed that out as
Heidi.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, it was just something online through the World Health Organization.
Mm-hmm.
It was free for any organization, just about background of pesticides.
Okay.
Just more FYI. It's available online, you can use it, but just a little bit about pesticides and risks and benefits. And just
okay.
All right,
yes,
great.
That's some of the research that I have done into it. This is sort of a
There's a lot more slides they had, but I kind of tried to filter through the more important ones because
mm-hmm.
Some of it's more worldwide than just like from the United States, a lot of worldwide pesticide problems. So.
Sure. Thank you. Good evening. We are just having a part of an open discussion before we entered into the public hearing. Had any public discussion items that you wanted to bring up, feel free.
Uh, Do you want any further public comment? Maybe we'll take a break until 6:15?
Well, yeah, I mean, I'm wondering if we may have time to look at the minutes.
That's a good idea.
Has everyone had a chance to review the minutes? I did just have a couple on some of the additions, whatever. There were some, I had my name misspelled a few times, so I just so I could.
Sorry.
But I know, Laura, you had had a question regarding the minutes from the last time with the additions. Are these?
The red is what I corrected.
Okay.
Mr. Chair, if we could, just in case anyone's watching, these are the minutes from August 16th, 2017, correct?
Let's see, August the 16th minutes, that is correct. Yeah, we do have two sets of minutes, I'm sorry, to look over. One was from August the 16th, which we deferred until tonight from our last meeting. And also the minutes from September the 19th, which was our last meeting.
And the red section is the things that I added that were on the video.
Now, how did you remember all of that, Laura?
I watched the video.
Okay.
Many times.
Then I'm, that's okay. Was there any questions regarding the minutes?
No, I wasn't involved. I wasn't here.
Oh, okay.
I guess so.
That's right.
That was only at the notes at September 1, so.
Okay. So I think I was the only person at the meeting. So, I mean, outside of the spelling, I believe that's fine. If you pretty much got those from the tape, I don't really see anything that I would object to.
Correct. I only see it once spelled incorrectly, is that right? Or is it throughout?
I'd have to look back.
Okay,
again.
I'll just correct your name.
Sure, perfect. So I guess I would be the only person that, I mean, you can put a motion out to the minutes.
I'm happy to put a motion on. I think just so we can get the minutes approved, I'm happy to.
Sure.
Even if it wasn't at the meeting, I did watch it on tape, happy to,
okay.
to approve the minutes.
Mm-hmm.
Otherwise, we're not going to get them approved.
Sure.
I mean, I can approve them if you say that they're, you know, that's exactly what happened. I didn't see it on video.
And motion to approve the minutes of August the 16th?
Seconded.
All in favor of approving the minutes of the 16th?
Aye.
3-0. And let's see, we still have 5 minutes. The minutes of the 19th of September, have everyone had a chance to review those?
Yes.
Yeah. I did not see a problem with them. It looks fine to me. Any other issues at all?
No. Make the motion.
Motion to accept the minutes of September 19th.
Second.
Seconded. All in favor?
Aye.
3-0. Wow.
few minutes. I know last time we, I asked the question in regards to the executive session minutes that need, still need to be released. I think they've been approved, is my understanding?
They have been approved, but they have not been released as far as I'm aware. We have not released them as a board.
So we'd want to do that, if not tonight, at the next meeting. I would assume to release those if the board is in agreement with it.
Okay, let me, yes, I mean, I have reviewed them. I'd like to just review them again one more time.
Okay.
We'll look over them. You have looked at the minutes?
I have not. I'm not sure if it's in my purview since I wasn't on the board at the time. That's a question that's above my head.
Okay, I'll have to look into that also.
It's not really material because they've actually already been approved, correct?
That's true.
This is just releasing them to the public. And the determination would be if the board feels the matters contained in them are resolved, then you can release them.
Right, but you would want to review them to see if you believe the issues have been resolved?
Again, I don't know if that's...
Let me check with the town clerk and see.
Yeah.
You would not want to approve them unless you felt that, you would not want to release them unless you felt that that was appropriate.
I'm just trying to think if you're okay is good enough, but I guess you make a good point. You should still see them since you're agreeing to approve, to release them.
Correct. I think as a board we should review them to determine whether we should release them.
Okay. Yep.
It's just as a matter of
to make sure everything contained in it is resolved.
Correct. And I believe you should be able to do that as a board member, but I will double check with that.
Okay. 3 minutes.
I was going to do my chair report, but let's hold off because that may be a few minutes.
Okay.
Sure, certainly.
Dan, you want to?
Did you want to sit up there?
Oh, goodness.
It's easy, you just all shifted one.
Yeah, so then again, the watch and the clock and the
sometimes it's a nightmare. Comes and goes.
At 6:15, I'd like to open the public hearing of the Board of Health. The Reading Board of Health will hold a public hearing at their meeting at the Public Library Community Room on Middlesex Ave on Wednesday, October 18th at 6:15 p.m. All interested citizens are invited to comment regarding proposed guidelines on pesticide application to town-owned tree lawns and sidewalks, which will be submitted to the Reading Board of Selectmen for regulatory review. Written comments may be submitted for the record to to the Reading Health Division at Town Hall. Copies of the proposed regulations are available at the Office of the Health Division at Reading Town Hall and on the town's websites at our website, Reading, www.readingma.gov. And I just want to welcome everyone to our public health meeting. We appreciate you taking the time to be here. The public hearing is for the public to discuss proposed pesticide regulations for the town of Reading. Copies of this proposal have been made available, and there is a copy over there if need be. The Reading Board of Health is a 3-member board that's appointed by the Board of Selectmen. The purpose of this board is to promote and protect the public health for the citizens of Reading. We derive our authority from the Massachusetts legislature, and the members are myself, John Costigan, Kevin Sexton, and Heidi Pfeiffer. Pesticide use has long been a controversial issue, and because of the broad interest in that use, the board has made the effort to provide a public forum for the exchange of ideas and views. Over many months, the board has reviewed other municipalities' regulations and have had open discussions to formulate a framework to best serve the residents of Reading. I'd like to thank everyone who came to share their views and gave valuable input to help create these reasonable regulations while maintaining the primary interest of the public health. Pesticides are in part defined as both herbicides, which are used to kill unwanted vegetation, such as weeds, and insecticides used to kill a host of unwanted pest and yard insects. Most everyone has encountered those small pellets on sidewalks during their neighborhood walks. If the adjacent lawn looks magnificent, there's a good chance that pellets do contain a pesticide. Many studies have demonstrated that lawn pesticides are making their way into our homes. Unfortunately, children seem to be the most susceptible for increased exposures. And as with many substances, increased levels in developing systems in children can be much more dangerous than in adults. In addition, pesticides have been detected in groundwater, which may leach into drinking water supplies. Of the commonly used pesticides, nearly half have been found to be toxic to pets, and almost all are toxic to the bees we need for pollination. These regulations are primarily concerned with town-owned public land only, consisting of sidewalks, tree lawns, and public right-of-way. Although the board has broad regulatory authority to require precautions to avoid potential dangers to the public health, the Board of Health respects Town Council's advice that control of town-owned land is the purview of the Board of Selectmen. As the purpose of this public hearing is to collect information and opinions, the board will not ask for any vote from the audience. After tonight's public hearing, the board will accept written testimony also, if there may be any. The board will then present our proposal along with all public comment to the Board of Selectmen at a later date to be scheduled. And all notifications will be available on our Board of Health website. Although under Massachusetts case law, municipalities cannot regulate or restrict the use of pesticides by homeowners or contractors on private property. As our proposed regulations state, we do encourage reduction or elimination of pesticides on private land as well. As we begin the public comment, we just ask that you adhere to the following ground rules. Any person wishing to make a comment should sign in. I think, has everyone signed in so far? The sign-in sheet. It will be used to call for public comments, and one may pass on commenting if so desired. When addressing the Board of Health, please identify yourself by name, address, and an affiliation if you have one. please limit your comments to 3 minutes so other members of the audience may have a chance to speak. We may be able to go over that possibly. And please be considerate of those speaking, whether you agree or disagree, and refrain from commenting out of turn. Thank you. And let's see. So we have the. Let's see. Wanda Lopez, you have signed in. Do you have any comments for the board?
No, thank you. Not at this time.
Okay.
Thank you.
Let's see. Is that Jahira? Did you have a comment for the board? Okay. Mary Ellen O'Neill.
Yes.
Did you have a
Mary
comment?
Ellen O'Neill, 125 Summer Avenue.
Mm-hmm.
This has long been a concern of mine, and it's only grown over the past years as I notice on my street in particular, and other streets as I walk around, the use of pesticides has only increased. As people put in new lawns, the little yellow signs go up, and in the spring, walk down what I think is a beautiful street, and it smells like sometimes like a chemical factory. There's no fresh smells at all. It's just stale, chemically smell from the pesticides and the fertilizers, heavy-duty fertilizers being put on lawns. I respect people's wish to have a nice lawn. I wish people would look into alternatives, alternative kinds of plantings, but also alternative organic uses and somehow to way to get that information out. But what I'm very much opposed to is being forced to walk when I brought my dogs or my grandchildren on sidewalks and tree lawns, and I have no choice but to walk on that material that's, they didn't lift the whatever they use. A spreader.
Yes.
It begins with an S. A spreader. Over, you know, the sidewalk, and I certainly don't think they should put them in the tree lawn, because then my alternative is to walk in the street, and that's not, you know, realistic on a lot of our, you know, main streets. So I think the least that we could do is to move forward with, you know, protecting our public properties and then encouraging, and I appreciate all of John's terrific comments at the beginning, and encouraging people to really look for alternatives to these products. And this is a great piece. I haven't seen it before, and I know it's put out by an international organization, but I just want to point out that if we were to use this for anything, it says inside pesticides, risks and benefits, risks toxic to humans, well, it's also toxic to animals. And in the back, further inside, where it talks about children's environmental exposure, potential for take home of pesticides on parents' clothing or shoes, that's what happens. They come in on the dog's paws or my shoes, or, you know, I know a lot of people don't, but you can do the best you can, but you can't like clean everything, and you're bringing those, you know, things into your house too, where even if you choose not to use them in your house, so, or your yard. So thank you for the opportunity
Thank you very much. Nancy Doctor?
Nancy Doctor, Pearl Street. I would actually first like to ask the Board of Health to formally acknowledge and thank Mary Ellen O'Neill, who actually brought this issue to the attention of the board almost 2 years ago. We would not be having this public hearing without having had her input. In addition, I'd like you to also consider acknowledging Gina Schneider, who along with Mary Ellen actually assisted in crafting the current guidelines you're looking at, and to extend some acknowledgement for the support of both the former tree warden, Bob Keating, and the Assistant Director of Public Works, Jane Kinsella. Bob Keating was actually very supportive. Those of you who know Bob actually lost a kidney, had cancer that was actually directly related to his use of pesticides in his job. Mm-hmm. So he was very supportive of these regulations. Exposure to contemporary use pesticides is actually greater than most people realize. Many populations of wildlife, dogs, and humans are exposed. The exposure occurs without the exposed individual's knowledge. A general lack of understanding by the public about pesticide and pesticide procedures has led to a false sense of security. That's a quote from the National Institute of Cancer. NIH further goes on to state, pesticide use poses a risk to human health. Pesticide exposure in humans has been associated with growth defects, learning disorders, respiratory illness, brain cancer, leukemia, non-Hodgkin's lymphoma, neurological disorders, including Parkinson's, brain damage, hyperactivity, attention deficit disorder, low sperm counts, testicular cancer, male infertility, immune system problems, and irregular hormonal activity. The health organizations that advocate pesticide use reduction include American Academy of Pediatrics, the American Public Health Association, Lymphoma Foundation, the American Brain Tumor Association, the March of Dimes, the National Academy of Sciences, the Massachusetts Senate and House of Representatives, and Massachusetts General Accounting Office, as well as the Environmental Protection Agency. People forget that Agent Orange is a herbicide. The Gulf War syndrome is directly related to pesticide use. Most people would not use pesticides if they knew about safe, effective, and economical alternatives for landscaping and pest control. This is what Mary Ellen was referring to. Hopefully the board can also pursue this, because the United States Environmental Protection Agency has promoted many alternatives under their integrated pest management and biopesticide programs. These techniques have been proven to be successful and to save money. Some of the books that are available are actually right here in the library, written by horticulture scientists, landscapers, and agricultural experts on non-chemical control of a multitude of human pests. If it takes a village, well, it takes a village to prevent contamination from pesticides, and I hope that Reading uses this as an opportunity to basically reduce our pesticide exposure to the public. Thank you for the board for taking this under consideration.
Right. Thank you, Nancy. And Carolyn Whiting, you have signed
Carolyn
in.
Carolyn Whiting, 17 Chestnut Road, and I do not have any detailed remarks, but I second everything that's been said over here. And I feel that my own health has been damaged by exposure to pesticides, because one of the things on that list was immune system problems, and that's what I have, multiple food and chemical sensitivities. And so I am very strongly supportive of reducing the use of pesticides. And I also agree that more education of the general public about how toxic these things are would be a great idea. Mm-hmm. And thank you for having this hearing.
Thank you. Thank you, Carol. I did also receive from Gina Snyder a written, actually it was a few months ago, but we did receive written comment from Gina, which I'd like to just read into the record. I am writing to express my strong support for regulations along the lines of those referenced in prior minutes in Marblehead, Massachusetts. I fully agree with the statements made in those regulations that all pesticides are toxic to some degree, and the commonplace widespread use of pesticides is both a major environmental problem, a public health issue, and all citizens, and in particular children, as well as other inhabitants of our natural environment, have a right to protection from exposure to hazardous chemicals. As you know, we did sort of draw from the Marblehead regulations for our regulations, which seem to be very, they currently have those regulations in their town. It goes on, I wrote to the Reading Board of Health in June of last year on the topic of protection of public health by the elimination of the use of toxic pesticides on town-owned land. I particularly suggested that the board adopt a language that it shall be unlawful for any person to use or apply any toxic chemical pesticides on any town-owned land or public right-of-way, including sidewalks, except as specifically authorized in these regulations. I am writing to encourage the adoption of regulations on pesticides to protect both people and their pets. I hope you will pass regulations and also educate the public and landscapers on the dangers of pesticides, especially now as use goes way up in the spring and summer. This was from in the spring. had asked for written communications. Did we receive any written communications since?
I didn't receive any.
Is there any other public comment?
No question, John. Now, I know it's going to Board of Selectmen. Will the Board of Health have a discussion and vote on this and make a recommendation to the Board of Selectmen?
We will. I'm not sure if we would like to do that this evening, but we will. We plan on taking this to the Board of Selectmen. I'm not sure, Dan, if we can get some time before the board, or would you?
We'll have to work it into a schedule. I will commit to getting it on the agenda.
And is there anything we can do to help you along with that, or to information that we can provide for you?
Information that could be distributed by PDF would be useful.
Okay.
And anything you have. A synopsis of the current state regulations would be useful. What does the state restrict, since they, under the law, apparently have a domain over this? Like, you know, what kind of restrictions?
Well, there is a whole pesticide law, so yes, we can.
Do you have a summary of that somewhere?
I don't know if I have a summary. I could pull up the actual regulations, but yeah. Mm-hmm.
Those two things.
Okay.
If I could, Mr. Chairman, happen to have the Board of Selectmen schedule in front of me, so just to provide a little bit of feedback on that, the next meeting is October 24th, which certainly
that one's full.
That's full.
Yeah.
And then November 7th, which I believe is also close to being full, if it isn't already. And then we go into town meeting starting November 13th. So we'll be tied up with town meeting. We never know, but we always prepare for four nights of town meeting. So that takes us through to after Thanksgiving. And then on November 28th, there's a Board of Selectmen meeting that has over half a dozen agenda items already booked on it. And then December 12th and December 13th, we're doing budgets. Those are budget meetings.
Okay.
So it's not saying it is or isn't, but that's what's been on the docket so far.
Okay.
I'm certain we can find some time before the next pesticide application season is upon us.
Sure, sure. Well,
in advance of that, I would.
Yeah.
Okay, we'll work with you on that,
sure.
Just to get that in. If we could maybe check our schedules too over the next couple months, see when we can work that in. That's Tuesday, every other Tuesday evening?
Generally every other, but
it depends kind of what else is going on.
But more during
the budget. I heard that I won't be around for.
Yeah.
November 7th, November 28th, and then we really go right into budgets.
It's kind of a step forward a month.
Yeah, week. Budgets have advanced into December. It's normally in January. So those Tuesday nights are already booked. Well, Tuesday the 12th is.
Okay, well, we can certainly let you know and put on our website when we do come up with a date on that. So we don't necessarily have to decide that tonight, but we will put that up on our website.
Mm-hmm.
Because I was hopeful that you wouldn't have it, you know, before, I mean, no urgency before the first of the year, but definitely before the spring.
Mm-hmm.
But you
yeah.
want some information out ahead of time, so maybe sometime in January we could get it, you know,
certainly.
Done proactively and put it on already.
Yep.
Because I thought the use, if we, you know, we could look into the use of getting some information out via the DPW, the next time the DPW newsletter goes out.
Mm-hmm.
So whenever, I was just thinking about water bills, when they go out, because sometimes they put those in with the water bill. To time it for one that's, you know, late winter, early spring.
Next one is December, probably, for the January payment. Water bill.
So then maybe the next one after that. So somehow to kind of coordinate all those things.
Okay, we will, yes, we will bring that up. We will do that. Is there any other comment? Yes.
So does the city have regulations over properties such as like parks and schools, or is that still?
that is all regulated by the state, what the schools can do. We have no purview over. That was one of the things that, in forming these regulations, there were a few things that we brought with town council, and that was one of the things that he was clear about, is we had no purview over the school regulations, school land.
And I believe the schools already have regulations against using them.
I think, is that a state?
It's a state regulation.
That's the state.
And one other thing in terms of record from DPW and from Bob Keating, the town very rarely uses pesticides. Very rarely. And when they do, it's for a very specific infestation. And in fact, these regulations, when DPW and Bob Keating reviewed them, there is an exception for just that concern. But they would approach the board about any particular use. I think the one that Bob Keating quoted was about gypsy moth.
Oh, sure.
So it's just, they really don't use pesticides except if there is a very specific issue.
How about mosquito spraying? Is that exempted?
That's not done by the town. That's done through the northeast.
Mosquito control.
Right.
And
it's
they offer
state.
Opt out.
I know that.
Yeah.
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 That's the state.
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah.
Just going, that legislation passed years ago was called the Massachusetts Families and Children's Protection Act, and it regulated pesticide use around the schools.
Daycare notification.
If people still did want to use them, so you could look that up.
I guess one question the board, if I could anticipate their questions, would be what additional restrictions would, if we adopt this, would be placed on the town's use over and above what the state currently limits? What's the change that would be
effectuated? Well, this basically is just public use on town land.
But the state currently regulates that to some degree? The type of, I'm sure they don't allow chlordane and things like that.
There are some restrictions on them, but as long as it's used within its labeled use,
yeah.
I believe it's allowed to be used.
That's the only restriction?
I believe so.
One other comment. When you go and you buy Roundup at Home Depot, when you read the label, what you don't understand is the state has classified that as dangerous. It's not safe. And people don't realize what they're actually exposing themselves to. It's considered not safe. And that's a state classification.
But as long as it's used as labeled, it's fine to use.
It's legal. Herbicides are legal too. Yes.
Any other questions? Should we close our public hearing?
Seeing there's no other public comment, I guess.
Okay, I will close the public hearing for this evening.
Do we need to vote for that, or we just close it?
I should probably make a motion to close.
Motion to close the public hearing on pesticide regulations.
All in favor, yes.
Yes.
3-0. 3-0, thank you. Well, thank you all for coming.
Thank you.
You're still welcome to stay. We're still in open meeting. That we still have deliberations. If you're welcome to stay. All right. Thanks, Al. For next on the agenda, we would have our chair report. Nancy left. I wanted to just, you may all know, but we don't have an associate member on our board anymore, and I wanted to thank Nancy. She if she was here a little earlier, I will thank her personally for her service on the board. She was actually the person that recruited me to serve on the board and asked me to serve. So it's quite sad that she is no longer on the board for that. She was brought up a lot of good points to the board, and I think we'll miss her. Also, I've asked Laura to, as far as our Narcan, our opiate problem in town, I've asked Laura to check in with Erica McNamara about the role that the Board of Health can have in the town, and maybe what association we can have working with our CASA to try to just get a handle on the scope of the opioid problem in town, and just looking into the possibility of maybe having Narcan available in town in establishments that may have open nights or have restrooms where things like that tend to happen an awful lot of. Erica has volunteered to come and speak before the board if you think that that's something that you would like to hear. Is any comment that maybe have Erica come and see if we can line her up for and meet for to speak before us at some point?
And she's going to speak upon what our CASA is doing, or about
our CASA and what the board, what role a board may be able to have in helping what their goals are.
You know, I'm always looking forward to hear from our CASA. So,
okay.
I think they've been doing a great job in town. I know they have been working off grant money as well, too. Something to bring up that
mm-hmm.
that they need. For the future to keep going, that grant money will be running out. So,
yeah.
You know, getting them in here and getting the public more aware of what they're doing, I think it'll only be a good thing for them and the town.
Okay. Yeah, I can definitely, I'll check in with her and see what she might have available.
It was my understanding in our conversation that we were going to have our CASA volunteers distribute them to the location. Was that not an option?
Distribute
the flyers for the restrooms and the different restaurants.
Okay, yep, that is something I think that they were looking to do. They may have started to do long ago, but I don't think they've followed up on it. But did you speak with Erica regarding that, or that?
Briefly, we had a little bit of a conversation about it. She said she was going to talk to you about it.
Okay.
I can call her again this week.
Yeah, because we briefly talked maybe a couple of weeks ago about maybe trying to start that up again. So yeah, that's part of what we can speak about, absolutely. And one other thing as far as the immunizations in town, I did speak with Jane Burns, the head of Elder Services, regarding what role we may be able to play in just promoting immunizations in town. I think as far as public health and prevention, in my opinion, immunizations is probably one of the most important things that we can be doing. And the more that people are aware of that, the better chance we would have of getting people to understand the role and the importance of immunizations. So I did speak with Jane. I'm going to hopefully meet with her at some point. We do have a flu clinics coming up, and Laura, could you maybe just announce the flu dates again?
Yep.
That would be great.
So there was one at the Senior Center on the 12th.
Mm-hmm.
There was another one at Walmart over the weekend on October 14th. There is one at the Reading Housing Authority on the 17th. There is one at the Coolidge School on the 24th. Another one at the Senior Center on the 13th. And actually today we just added one at Town Hall for the 23rd.
23rd of.
And this is the super flu vaccine.
It's all of them.
The high test.
Yep. And then we also have housebound visits.
Yes,
if anyone needs them, they can call Sue. And she's more than willing to give out her cell phone number and go directly to them.
Mr. Chairman, I was a recipient of one of those shots on the 12th, and I can attest to the fact that it was a full house. They had that leaf turn people away at the end.
Yep.
So it was a very popular program.
Okay.
I was in the room with two former selectmen.
Oh, okay.
We were all there, and it was run very well.
Yes. Now, where on the Board of Health website would those dates be if people had to, wanted to find out where, you know, if they went to the section
to the right and typed in flu.
So it's
I just looked it up and they all came up.
It's right up on our website there.
And it also went out in the biweekly notes.
Okay. Very good. And let's see. As far as the health agent report, Laura, do we have a report for this evening?
Yep. Well, a section of that was the flu vaccines that we just went over.
Okay.
And where they're located. Then the rest of the month was pretty much routine. We did food inspections, re-inspections, some complaints, and we did the 3B coalition meeting. We did meet all our receivables for that meeting after our flu vaccine, so all our deliverables are done. And we received credit for the 100 and 700 FEMA training that I did.
Okay.
How was your soils course? Dirty business.
Yes. Many days of touching dirt.
I don't want to know, right?
One issue that came up was regarding our meeting nights. Would changing to Tuesday evenings be a problem for anyone to meet?
Would it be for me?
It wouldn't be for me, just maybe the next, I don't know, my schedule's already made out until
okay.
the beginning of December. So
okay.
it would be, I mean, I could probably get here by 6. That would be a little late. But then going forward from December, and if I know the dates, I can get
okay.
the day off. So I was actually wondering if we could meet here next time. What do you think of that?
Well, we could.
Yeah, I do have selectmen meetings Tuesday, but they start at 7, so they would
yep.
dovetail, I think, with your... Are you still going to stick to 5:30?
5:30 would be fine.
That's usually adequate
we,
time to
yep.
get out by 7. So that's actually an improvement for me, because it's one night.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Two meetings. I want to commend you for your efforts to save the town some overtime. That's
okay.
much appreciated.
Now,
I know that was the intention.
Would it be easier for you to meet in town hall, so you just have to go next
well,
door, or is that an
I
issue?
I could be
or?
Flexible on that. Yes, it would, but you know, I don't want to be the driver. This is a very nice room.
It's close enough. Huh? You could run there pretty fast.
We paid for this place, so I don't use it, right?
Okay.
Sure.
Well, let's look into our, well, does anyone have a... Did you want to try for like the third Tuesday of the month?
That's the 14th.
It'll be November 14th.
That doesn't sound like anything is going on.
14.
The 21st.
Oh, I'm sorry.
7.
Oh, I went that way. That's fine.
Yeah.
No, the 15th.
That's Thanksgiving week.
Tuesday, no?
Is that an issue for people? Are you okay?
Not for me.
Week of
not
Thanksgiving.
For me. What is it, the 21st? The 21st, that's Thanksgiving
I
week.
I do to work that Tuesday.
Yeah.
I
mean, I'm working till Friday.
I haven't really reset my schedule because they schedule me and I tell them when. And I'm due to work that Tuesday of Thanksgiving week. So, but I believe I could do the following Tuesday.
That's the Board of Selectmen night, the 28th.
Okay.
That's the
14th?
Tuesday after.
That's fine.
The 14th I'm due to work.
Okay.
November, 3 o'clock. I might be able to do... Heidi, have you got the 14th, Tuesday the 14th? Are you...
I'm working until like 5:30. Usually I leave at 5, so I got here about 10 of 6 today, but
okay.
there's no traffic. But Tuesday before Thanksgiving, the traffic's always really bad.
Yeah, let's not
like,
do that.
Yeah,
let's
from Boston, I know that day worse than the Wednesday. Wednesday probably people are, I could do Wednesday.
What
did
you say, John, the 28th?
Is that the 28th? Yes, the 28th
okay.
would be a Tuesday evening. If should we shoot for that?
Yep.
All right.
6 p.m. here?
Let's do 5:30. 5:30?
5:30 here?
Okay.
Is that November 28th? That's a Tuesday?
Yes,
the 28th.
Thank you.
Chairman, I'm going to have to leave in a second.
Sure.
I did want to make one point about the upcoming appointment process. We're in the process of looking at all the boards, committees, commissions. We've never really advertised associate positions before. They were kind of filled as they came up.
Mm-hmm.
If we had more suitable candidates from openings. What we're doing is getting the whole list together, all the boards, committees, commissions. We should have that by Monday. And there's going to be a blanket in Verdes for all those full-time that may be still vacant as associate.
Okay.
And then we will meet as resumes come in. We have to wait the statutory 15 days. We're going to be extremely respectful of that going forward. And then we'll be in a position to, at the earliest 15 days, probably Monday.
Okay. And there's generally one associate member per board?
It's
is
a,
that?
Depends.
It's a, there's a formula in the charter, and
okay.
We're going to work it out for each board, and we will authorize up to the maximum. And I may want to contact the chairs to see how many they really can use.
Mm-hmm.
They may or may not want the max filled up. But I don't think it's going to be an issue because
okay.
We usually have a lot more openings than candidates.
Okay. Yeah, I think what's it defined, Dan? Less than the quorum, I believe, right?
I'm sorry?
I believe it's defined by less than a quorum for associate
it's,
number of associate positions
it may
per
be
board.
It's like 50% minus one or something.
It's a little bit different, too.
You guys get one. Yeah.
We get
yeah.
one.
It's
right.
like two minus one.
Yeah.
Okay, I think you're right. Yeah.
CPDC has a different set of
one
rules,
one,
so.
They do. They have
oh,
one.
Right, right.
Yeah. It gets a little.
Caitlin's figuring all that
yeah.
out. She's got all the whys and wherefores. All right. Thank you for a productive
right.
hearing.
Yeah.
I
thank you.
Go.
Thanks, Dan.
Take care.
Just with respects to the Narcan, I just don't know what the liability, you know, if a firefighter gives Narcan or a police officer, but as
right.
opposed to someone in a restaurant, you know, I don't
mm-hmm.
know if they're covered liability-wise or the so
yeah,
as
I'm,
opposed
I'm,
to a trained professional, but maybe
right.
that's
yeah,
she
I'm
could
not,
come in and explain.
That would, that's a good point.
I know if it's like your own house, like I could do it if you're a kid, you know,
right.
it doesn't.
Right.
I don't know, like, if you and there's a Good Samaritan laws, but I don't know if that covers
yeah,
giving
that would,
someone an injection. And if it doesn't work and they, you know,
mm-hmm.
they don't make it. And
yeah, I'm not sure if that would be covered under the Good Samaritan. That
yeah.
would be a something to look into, too. And
yeah.
Erica may have some of that information.
Yeah.
So
I mean, I know, like, paramedic, you know, the EMTs can
mm-hmm.
do it.
Mm-hmm.
So that's just my only concern is, you know, let me, you know, see what the town, you know, if businesses would be covered. Maybe just more of a awareness to call 911. You know, like we're not that the police, the fire
sure.
aren't that far. Reading's so small, there's not, you know, wouldn't take that long for a first responder to get someone. That's what.
Okay. Yeah, thanks. That definitely worth looking into. And I think Erica may actually be able to. And I'm doing some research myself on. Aspect of what would be involved if we were to try to go on that path. In a lot, it would be completely voluntary too. You know, I mean, a lot of institutions might not or may not want to get involved in that, which I could understand, but some may. So, anything else from the board or?
I just have a question. I know one of the members of the public dropped something off. I didn't know if that was for the discussion.
This is for John. Nancy thought this would be a good source to give to the Board of Selectmen for reference.
Oh, okay.
To provide information to them, she said.
Yeah, that's
so
like
it's an informational link to more
yeah, that's
on
like
pesticides?
I had printed it. I don't know. It's a big packet. That
okay.
you can get online.
Okay.
Is
one you handed out?
Not that one,
oh.
but it was one I brought to another meeting
okay.
About
pesticides.
Yeah, about Lexington, Wellesley, different.
Okay.
Like.
Funded by Executive yeah, Office of Environmental Affairs.
Yeah, it's just how a lot of the other towns have gotten there.
Oh, okay.
And they say you can use it also, basically. So yeah, you can get it on the link.
Mm hmm.
I can't remember if that link doesn't work. Actually, I tried. Nancy had sent it to me, and
yeah.
I had to look it up myself. Though. I'm not sure if that link actually
mm-hmm.
works. But.
Yeah, it's from May of 2002, so I'm not.
Yeah.
I can try and look it up and see what.
Yeah.
But but it...
I mean, most of the other towns have done these kind of pesticide regulations like 15 years, you know, 10, 15, 20 years ago, so we're a little coming slow behind.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, thank you. Let's see, anything else we have? I don't need a motion to adjourn here, do we?
Sure,
okay,
I'm always
sure
going to take a motion to adjourn.
All right. Do I hear a motion to
adjourn? Motion to adjourn.
Cindy, second?
Yes, second.
And all in favor, we can adjourn our meeting. Thank you. Thank you much. Thank you.
Is it Dr. Costa?
No.